Declining fish populations, coral erosion, polluted waters. The human impact on the world's oceans has scientists and other observers on edge and calling for action.
It's an international issue because the reason why the high seas are being plundered is they don't belong to any nation in particular.
Fights over scarce resources can yield impressive and destabilizing unintended consequences.
A look at the health of the world's seas, next on Great Decisions.
In a democracy, agreement is not essential, but participation is.
Foreign policy is actually not foreign, and it is very much connected to every American's daily life.
It is crucial for our democracy that our citizens understand what our challenges are.
We can either choose to deliberately influence the shape of international events, or we can sit on the sidelines and let someone else shape those events.
We have to study. We have to listen carefully. We have to be critical in our judgments about what we hear.
There is not any issue that happens abroad that doesn't affect Americans directly.
A kind of global commons has been created in security and economic terms. And the United States has taken the leading role in creating it.
The ultimate test is to move our society from where it is to where it has never been. And that requires the participation of informed, committed, and concerned citizens.
We need to shape a balance of power that favors freedom for our prosperity, for our security, and for the future of our children.
A lot of people don't realize that the final arbiter of policy in our democracy is the will of the American people.
They're counting on you to tell the leaders of your country what you want to see happen with the foreign policy of the United States of America.
With more countries facing common challenges, we have the chance and the profound responsibility to exercise American leadership to solve our problems, and wherever we can, in concert with others.
Join us as we discuss today's most critical global issues. Join us for Great Decisions.
Great Decisions is produced by the Foreign Policy Association, inspiring Americans to learn more about the world. Great Decisions is produced in association with the University of Delaware. Sponsorship of Great Decisions is provided by Credit Suisse, E&I, the Hereford Foundation, and PricewaterhouseCoopers LLP. Coming up next, Living Planet, State of the Seas.
Welcome to Great Decisions. I'm Ralph Begleiter. Joining us today to discuss the state of the seas are Carl Safina, founder of the Blue Ocean Institute, and David Helvarg, president of the Blue Frontier Campaign. Gentlemen, what is the state of the seas? Give us a report card, David.
Well, unfortunately, the seas are in trouble, which means we're all in trouble because a lot of coastal and national economies really depend on healthy and abundant oceans. Unfortunately, although we don't see a lot of it directly, there's these cascading problems and threats from industrial overfishing for the global seafood market to oil, chemical, plastic, and nutrient pollution runoff from urban farms and urban cities and agriculture that the United Nations has identified 450 dead zones in the world. We're losing, developing coastal wetlands and other essential habitats that are really act as the nurseries and filters of the sea. And on top of all this, we have fossil fuel-fired climate change, which is warming the world ocean, melting Arctic ice, and changing the basic chemistry of the ocean through this process called acidification. So there's some real serious problems and challenges facing us in terms of the global seas.
Carl, your assessment?
Similar. I would say severe depletion from overfishing in much of the ocean, the warming and the acidification of the water caused by burning fossil fuels, and various kinds of pollution, either nutrients from farm runoff of fertilizer, or toxic chemicals, or hormones that go through people first and then get into the water and mess up the sex lives of fish and polar bears and things like that, and plastic, which basically lasts forever and is usually used to package something that only has a shelf life of a couple of weeks.
Would you characterize these problems that you've listed as urgent problems requiring immediate attention?
I think they're very urgent. We just had a report, a consortium of scientists who met several months ago at Cambridge, put out a report stating that we're facing the threat of marine extinctions at a level never seen, certainly in human history. And I think everybody who's studying the situation recognizes that there's now some urgency. We've had two, in the United States, two major reports on the state of the ocean, the Pew Oceans Commission and the U.S. Commission on Ocean Policies that came out in 2003 and 2004. The Pew report said that we really need change rapidly. Admiral Watkins, who headed up the U.S. Commission, said we have basically 10 years to act. And actually, the head of the Pew Commission, Leon Panetta, who's now our Secretary of Defense, expressed similar urgency that we need to take corrective action. And the frustrations is that we know what a lot of the solutions are. We need to create the political will in local, regional, national, and globally to respond.
Great Decision spoke to some other experts as well about this. Let's listen to what they have to say for a moment.
The ocean, we have one ocean, many seas, as you've said, but one ocean, is undergoing some severe threats. Those threats include unsustainable fishing management, pollution, whether in the form of plastics or runoff from our fertilizers, the effects of climate change, as well as I'm adding another sort of threat, and that is lack of awareness of the public about how important the ocean really is.
One of the key laws is Law of the Sea, which was an international treaty the United States has yet to ratify. That's an issue about how we defend the rights of the sea. Who has rights to the minerals in the sea? Who has rights to the fisheries? How do we protect against international pollution affecting the stability of marine life? These are issues where the United States must maintain a strong international presence.
The oceans are like Somalia. There's no governance. There's valuable stuff and no governance. And so what we see is a free-for-all plundering the oceans.
The ocean is the life support system for our entire planet. It regulates our climate. It allows for the rainfall that generates our water supply. It feeds billions of people around the world as our primary protein source. Half of the oxygen in your very next breath is coming from the ocean. So there is a very tight link between the systems that the ocean provides and our fresh water supply.
Let me pick up on something and ask both of you that Paul Collier mentioned. He said there's no governance. You both confront these issues. Is there a system politically and economically for dealing with the problems that you're raising, Carl?
Well, first of all, there is governance within about 200 miles of the shores of the countries of the world. And then beyond that, it is a global commons. And there is really no governance. There are some agreements subject to whether the governments decide to honor their agreements or not. So I think he's right to that extent.
And David, this is sort of one of these problems that where there are no boundaries or where political boundaries stop before the problem exists?
Well, as Carl said, there's the 200-mile exclusive economic zones, which covers about one-third of the world's oceans. And then there's a lot of the larger global commons. And there are not enough, but there are a few agencies and efforts. The Law of the Seas Convention is an example, which is supposed to be the global standard administered through the UN for establishing rights of passage, scientific exploration, conservation measures. Unfortunately, the United States is not a signatory to the Law of the Seas Convention, and so in areas like the Arctic, where we're seeing the loss of sea ice and the Arctic nations are moving in to claim resources and extend their EEZ territories, the U.S. is mapping up there, mapping extensions of our exclusive zone, but we don't really have the authority to be full participants because the Senate has been sitting on this ratification of this treaty for over 30 years.
And why doesn't the U.S. sign it? Why doesn't the U.S. sign up to something like this? What are the prospects of that changing?
It's troubling because originally, the one conflict was over during the Reagan administration was over deep sea mining, and that got resolved during the Clinton administration. And at this point, this is one of those agreements that has wide, really almost universal agreement within the maritime community. The shipping industry, the Pentagon, and Greenpeace agree on this. This is one of the few places where the NRDC and the oil companies are in agreement that the U.S. should be at the table. The right wing sees it as a threat to sovereignty. Years ago, when I asked when Jesse Helms, so we're going back to the 1990s, when he was in charge of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, he simply stated that he wasn't going to be part of any body in which the U.S. vote wasn't greater than any other vote. And unfortunately, this seems to be the issue today.
Coming back then to the question of what do we do about it? If the U.S. is not a signatory, are there other bodies? Do the rest of the nations of the world have it under control and just it'll be under control without the United States participation?
We can do bilateral agreements. For example, Jane Lubchenco, the head of our National Oceanographic Atmospheric Administration, just signed an agreement with the new Finnish fisheries minister for the European Union to fight what they call IUU, illegal, underreported, and unregulated fishing. And so we can send out the Coast Guard and the European Coast Guard and begin to try and control some of the pirate fishing out there. There are other agreements. There's an international agreement on dumping that prevents dumping of plastic at sea. Unfortunately, it doesn't deal with the greater part of plastic that washes off our shores and ends up becoming a persistent issue of pollution on the high seas. And I think one bit of good news is actually very recently we had the formation of Senate Oceans Caucus, where to date 19 senators have signed on and saying the ocean, the protection of not only our exclusive economic zone, but the ocean as a whole, is of importance. It's critical for, coastal economies, for, we get so much from the ocean in terms of, recreation and transportation and trade and energy and protein that we're beginning to see some recognition. We have to give something back in terms of rational management and long-term agreements.
Well, you both mentioned some of these problems before, the pollution, the actual pollution problems before, but let's take a listen to what some of our other experts have to say about what these problems are, where they are, and then we can talk a little bit about how to go about resolving them.
From an ecological perspective, trash in the ocean is choking wildlife. It's derelict fishing gear, entangles whales and dolphins and seabirds and all kinds of fish that we love to eat and love to enjoy watching. But billions of dollars are spent in coastal communities cleaning up trash, and there's enormous lost tourism revenue. And it's a health concern to have these kinds of items all over our coastlines.
There's a lot that we know, there's a lot that we don't know. But we know that sea levels are rising and we're losing valuable wetlands and protections for shoreline erosion. That's becoming more difficult for the Bay, all as a result of the global issues.
So the ocean is very, very important in the climate system in terms of the cycles of water, the global cycles of water, heat, and carbon. And some of the impacts that increasing climate change has on the ocean is a growing acidification of the ocean. That is a threat to the livelihood of these coral reef ecosystems. So that's one of the sort of global impacts on the ocean associated directly with the uptake of extra carbon dioxide in the atmosphere.
Carl Safina, a lot of a veritable menu of problems in the ocean. I want to ask you whether the sheer number of different problems in the ocean has caused a movement to be too diverse to bring about the kind of economic and political action necessary to deal with it. Is everybody concerned about their own problem in the ocean and not working together to solve them?
It goes back to this question of sovereignty, which at one time made sense. But when these issues affect everybody, when fishing in the ocean catches many fish that swim into national waters, then it affects all of these countries, and the countries really need to agree. But we don't seem psychologically or emotionally up to the task, at least not yet.
Let me pose a devil's advocate kind of question here for just a second that relates to that. It seems to me that in places where, like the United States, you have a very high level of unemployment. That's true in Europe as well. You have banks failing. In Somalia and Sudan, you have famine going on. In the Middle East, there are democratic uprisings occurring. In a wide variety of places, people have a lot of very pressing issues on their hands, and it seems hard for me to imagine that they're thinking very much about the plastic in the ocean or about the coral reefs or about the, you know, the polar bears in the Arctic. Is that part of the problem you're just putting your finger on, which is there's not enough political there to force nations to act on it?
Well, there is a lot of there. It's sometimes hard for people to understand. In this country, for example, the ocean sector is actually a larger part of the economy than the farm sector. You know, you look at piracy in Somalia, it got started really when fishermen were no longer able to fish. You know, foreign fleets were coming and depleting the waters, and they turned pirates. And I've talked to a Navy admiral who recognizes this is now a national security issue, that protecting a large parts of the ocean for restoration might be an issue so that the tens of millions of artisanal fishermen around the world, the local fishermen, don't lose their resource to foreign fleets, don't turn to piracy or other desperation measures. I know certainly, as I said, Leon Panetta, the Secretary of Defense, came up through, you know, a family in Monterey, lived, you know, grew up when it was a healthy fishing community, and spent his life sort of understanding the issues. I just got off 2 weeks ago off a Navy ship, the Macon Island, an amphibious assault ship that's gone to a hybrid propulsion system. It's burning one-third the fuel of other ships of its class. The Department of Defense is beginning to recognize that issues, natural resource issues, issues of climate, are also security issues.
Can you see that playing out in the presidential election in the United States, for example? Are people going to be asking the candidates about it?
I think that's a potential, certainly in coastal states like California, where there's a lot of interest. And it's something that if the president chooses, he could distinguish himself on, because in the summer of 2010, he established a first U.S. ocean policy that's committed to what they call ecosystem-based marine spatial planning. It's what Admiral Thad Allen, former commandant of the Coast Guard, calls putting urban planning in the water column. So we begin to look at the whole system instead of having a first come for a license, first get to use it attitude, what Carl was talking about, this kind of attitude that it's a commons, therefore it's for anybody. We have to understand it's really a public seas. We own it all, and we have, you know, responsibility for it, and we can govern it correctly. The president's done something good on paper. Now he has to implement it, and hopefully it could become a campaign issue.
I think the problem, as always, is that most people care mostly about what their immediate problems are. And most people simply don't see the ocean. They don't hear about the ocean. The president has gotten pretty shy about environmental issues. And the vast majority of people care about the environment, but they vote based on the economy.
You mentioned plastics a few minutes ago, and I want to just ask about that huge island in the Pacific Ocean that's essentially, it's not an island, but a swirling mass of plastic, I guess. Good example seems to me to fit your point just now about people don't see it. Most people don't fly over it. People don't take a cruise through it. And it's not in anyone's particular control. Isn't that emblematic of the problem you just talked about?
Yeah, the plastic problem in the ocean is emblematic because it's a problem that we create. We use this packaging and we discard it and it washes into the sea. And it does things that none of us ever hear about, except people like David and me who have been to some of these places and see what it does to wildlife and the incredible rate at which it has been accumulating over the last decade or so.
And I mean, the scary parts, we produce about 200 million metric tons of plastic a year, and half of that, 100 million metric, is, as Carl said, for packaging. It's throwaway. Yeah, I come from California, and as Sam Farr, congressman from the mid-state, says, it's in California you can win or lose an election based on your position on coastal protection and offshore oil. And I think that California is more advanced because people have the sense of entitlement. They understand the beach and the ocean belongs to them, and as a result, we have really good policies. And where we killed off the elephant seals and the sea otters, they've come back because people made choices. And a lot of those choices are that people recognize their economies tied to it. When President Obama, who is an advocate for expanded offshore drilling, sent his Secretary of Interior to California, there was a whole delegation, hundreds of people, and Senator Boxer stood up and said, we have $35 billion of value in keeping our oceans oil-free, and we're not going to trade that off for some, you know, potential short-term, you know, production.
Both of you have mentioned the cost in fishing and other sea life. Let's talk about that now, and let's hear what some of our other experts have to say on that part of the subject.
Fewer and fewer fish are going to be able to reproduce themselves. And once the fish stock for a particular species falls below a critical level, they can't reproduce themselves. They can't find each other. If that process continues unregulated, our grandchildren won't have a lot of species. Either that troubles you or it doesn't. I think that ethically, we have a responsibility to pass on to future generations the renewable assets that we ourselves benefit from.
One of the ways that trash in the ocean and plastic specifically is affecting wildlife is that it's breaking down into tiny little microparticles that are then being ingested by fish. And that's happening with seabirds too.
The conflict over fisheries is serious and it's real, and it can lead to a number of unanticipated crises. For instance, when we think of piracy off the coast of Somalia, we don't think about it as being related to fish. But as the story goes, because Somalia was in a state of basically conflict, they weren't able to protect their territorial sea or their exclusive economic zone. So a number of fishing industries located in Asia came into the exclusive economic zone of Somalia and even to the territorial sea and started overfishing because there was no quota, there was no enforcement. So Somali folks took to boats, got their RPGs, went out and captured some of these fishing vessels. And then they realized, whoa, this could be a business.
I think it's pretty obvious that we've relied on, a lot of the world population relies on fish as a, in many cases their sole source of protein, particularly in some of the developing world. Our practices of how we fish and how we manage fisheries is basically unsustainable as you look at the depletion of particularly the top predators in our fishing communities. Aquaculture is one way in order to alleviate the pressure on wild fish, but you have to do that sustainably as well. And so sustainable practices in aquaculture is a key thing that we should be really seriously looking at.
Carl Safina, you wrote a book called Song for the Blue Ocean, and you produced a TV series called Saving the Ocean. The issue of preserving the fish in the ocean seems like a no-brainer, and yet it's fraught with political and economic implications. What's the way out that you can see?
Well, it's fraught with political and economic implications because the people who are depleting it are here now, and they're doing just fine for themselves by depleting it. The people who are going to be saddled with that depletion are not here to speak up for themselves. So Paul Collier said that it's an ethical problem, and basically it is.
What about what seems to me anyway to be a rather simple or well-defined problem, like abandoned fishing equipment and nets and other kinds of gear that are used? That seems to me to be a pretty easy and obvious thing to fix, and yet it seems to be beyond our ability to fix that. Carl?
Well, there's so much of it, and you have to mount an expensive expedition to go get it. You basically have to do everything you would do to go fishing in order to snag all the lost gear. So it's not that simple.
I got to throw you a difficult question here at the end. I'm sure you've thought about it. If someone asks you, how much would it cost if you could write your own ticket, how much would it cost to fix the problems in the oceans, ranging from the lost equipment to the fish to the oil, environmental pollution, to all of those problems. Do you have a number? What would it cost the world economy to fix it?
Probably less than 1% of our GDP. I mean, as I say, I'm from California. We have $1.5 trillion economy even in the recession, and 2/3 of that's in our coastal counties. The funny thing is when you do right by the ocean, it turns out that it also tends to be right for you in terms of your pocketbook, as well as your health, as well as political stability. The challenge, as Carl said, is there's a lot of short-term economic interests that don't want to see change, and there's lots of institutional inertia. So you really need to, the people who understand it, and I think those numbers are growing, have to be politically engaged to help make it real.
Carl, maybe a final word on that question of the cost of fixing
a
problem.
I don't think in those terms. I don't think of the cost of fixing a problem. If a problem is fixed, it's a tremendous net benefit. So the question is, what would people get if we refilled the sea with fish and we allowed the sea turtles and the whales to recover and the water to be clean. Billions of people rely on fish. There are, I don't know how many billions of dollars in tourist revenue that are at stake from the declining coral reefs of the world. Those would continue to produce or produce at a higher level than they are. So if I thought it was a net cost, I wouldn't want to do it, but it's an incredible net benefit.
Carl Safina and David Helvarg, thank you both for being with us on Great Decisions. And thank you as well for joining us. I'm Ralph Begleiter. We'll see you next time.
To join a discussion group in your area or order a DVD of this series, visit greatdecisions.org or call 1-800-477-5836. Great Decisions is produced by the Foreign Policy Association, inspiring Americans to learn more about the world. Great Decisions is produced in association with the University of Delaware. Sponsorship of Great Decisions is provided by Credit Suisse, E&I, the Hereford Foundation, and PricewaterhouseCoopers LLP.
Next time on Great Decisions, Indonesia was the childhood home of President Barack Obama. It's also the world's most populous Muslim country, a secular democracy, and an economic rising star.
We're the third largest democracy in the world now, and we're the largest democracy in Southeast Asia, with the largest middle class and with great political stability.
What challenges does Indonesia, a former dictatorship, face in the region and the world? And what is the state of U.S.-Indonesian relations today? Next time on Great Decisions.